So in the previous class, I had given you a bunch of problems to try out. Many of them I had already told you the solutions to. I hope you've tried to complete at least this one particular problem that I had given, which was to find rational solutions of this. Have you completed the solution of this? Because if you do, you'll find out there are some issues with it, even after we've parameterized. If you work this through, you'll see that you get that radical. And when we are asking for rational solutions, right, things inside the radicals must be perfect squares, right? So if you just substitute all possible rational values for that parameter, which is the ratio of x to y, yeah, I'm referring to the problem that we discussed the previous day, right? Then not every value would work. Only those values corresponding to which the entry inside that radical, inside that square root is a perfect square of a rational number. Only those would work, right? So please try this. It's very important, particularly because subsequently we shall be talking about what kind of solutions are we looking for. In general, are we looking for solutions that are real, that are natural numbers, that are complex numbers, and so on and so forth. But all that in good time. Before that, let's just do some usual routine stuff that you are familiar with. As I said, it's linear algebra, so we'll be solving linear equations, right? So of the form, let's say 2x plus 5y is equal to 12, and 3x plus 2y is equal to, let's say 7, something like this, right? You know how to solve this. You've done this. There are so many methods. One of the methods is just, you know, what you learned in middle school. Just multiply this by a certain term, this by a certain term, subtract one from the other, get rid of one of these unknowns, right? As it turns out, in this course, we shall give it a name, a special name, which we call taking linear combinations of equations, right? So that cancellation that you did, what you essentially did was a linear combination. There are, of course, other methods. You might have used the determinant, particularly when you had more unknowns, like a 3-by-3 system. You might not have preferred the elimination of one variable at a time. You might have used the determinant, and then, you know, the inverse of a matrix you could have used. For example, if a matrix is invertible, you know that it's given by the adjugate of the matrix A divided by its determinant, yeah, and all these things. But you might have lost much of the intuition behind what's going on when you actually cancelled these equations, which is what we call now linear combinations. So let us investigate what initially worked for us right when we first encountered these objects in our middle school. And let us try to see where that takes us, right? Try to get an algorithmic kind of a structure, if I may call it that, towards solving these equations. And then we can have some hope that we will be able to mimic it for a host of other problems. Because once we have a structure, an algorithm that works, we can apply it to other cases too, right? It should be scalable. So that's the goal. So what is it that we are essentially doing? Let's write it in the most generic form. The equation looks something like this. Let's just deal with real numbers for the time being, and we are looking for solutions that are also real. So this, let's say B, is this. Let's say the unknowns, that is this, and of course A has to then be of size m cross n. So this is a standard way of representing m equations in n unknowns, right? So each equation is like a constraint. Once again, I'll provoke you to think a little geometrically. Of course, that geometric thought doesn't go beyond three dimensions. But let's think about it in three dimensions itself. So if I give you the equation of, say, 3x plus 4y plus 7z is equal to 8, what is this? It's a plane, right? So if I ask you to solve for this equation, what does it geometrically mean? It means that I can sketch this, yeah, x, y, z, whichever way you like, some right-handed system. So I can just sketch this plane in some manner. And basically, every point on this plane is a solution. Now, If I add another plane's equation, say 7x plus 5y plus 10z is equal to 14, which is not necessarily parallel to this. Just think geometrically. It means we are talking about a second plane which probably intersects this plane. I don't know how, but in some manner. Now, when I'm asking for the solution, the set of solutions has been cut down. You realize that, right? Earlier, every point on this first plane was a feasible solution to the linear equation. But remember, that is also a system of linear equations. You might call it just one equation. It is still fitting in with this structure, doesn't it, right? Because you can just say that m is equal to 1, n is equal to 3. This is also of the form ax is equal to b. Now we are adding one more equation where m becomes 2, n still remains 3. But what is happening is that now your solutions are confined to a line, which is fewer points as you might expect, right? Now if I choose carefully a third equation, and I'm hoping I'm choosing good enough equations that are not, you know, dependent or whatever. We'll come to that term dependent later. Then what we expect is that we will have a third plane. And now we'll talk about a single point, hopefully, right? So we are cutting down the possibility of solutions. It's as if with the imposition of every additional equation, you're imposing more and more constraints. Initially, you are free to choose solutions on this whole plane. Then I cut it down by one by adding one more constraint, and now you could choose solutions only within a line. And if I have imposed a hard constraint, which is more restrictive, then now I'm asking you to choose only one point, right? So it's as if I first, before someone enters this room, you're free to loiter around this room, right? And then when probably the instructor comes in, you're expected to take your seat somewhere. Yeah, and if the instructor is like a very strict one and says, no, you cannot chit chat, you cannot discuss with anybody, then you're sort of like, you have to look forward. So your degrees of freedom are being curtailed with the imposition of every single constraint. It's a very fundamental principle. So the number of constraints, okay, plus the number of degrees of freedom, yeah, this turns out to be a constant. For those of you who have done a preliminary course on linear algebra, you might recognize this as some form of the so-called rank nullity theorem. Okay, we'll revisit it later, the implications of this, but this is true. All right, we'll see how this can be manifested through the rank nullity theorem. But at least at this level, through this geometric construction of this, whatever pathetic drawing this might look like, I hope you appreciate that you are imposing more and more constraints, and therefore your degrees of freedom are being reduced, right? So that is what the addition of every equation does. When you're keeping the number of unknowns fixed, but you're adding more and more constraints, it might even so happen that your existence might be, you know, something undesirable, in the sense that I give you some infeasible set of equations which have no solutions, which means someone doesn't want you in his or her home. You're an undesirable guest, right? So that means there's no solution, no freedom for you at all. Forget about freedom, even your existence is not desirable, right? So that is what I hope you get an intuitive idea about what this means. But we will go about it in a more formal fashion, and we will, of course, try to look beyond three dimensions, for which we need abstraction. We need some sort of an algorithm that works each and every time. So what is it that we would want to do? These equations, with increase in the number of variables or unknowns, become more and more challenging to eliminate one by one, the number of variables and the number of operations. And it seems like it's something based on observation. You look at these numbers, you look at 2 there, you look at 5 there, you look at 7 there, and you think, multiply this by 7. There has to be a systematic way, right? We want some structure so that someday a computer can do the same thing that you are doing through observation. We don't want that vagueness in the picture. So what is it that allows us to do so? If this A matrix has a nice structure, perhaps it will be easier for us to solve for this. The simplest thing I can think of is when it's a square matrix and the A matrix is just identity. The most desirable case, the easiest case, the trivial case, right? But of course, when you have M and N different, you cannot have an identity. So how do we go about this business of simplifying the structure of this A matrix while ensuring that we are looking for exactly the same solutions, mind you? So if you are tweaking this system of equations, you should not be looking for a restricted subset of the solutions, neither you should you be looking for spurious solutions that were not solutions of the original system. So what do you have to preserve? When you are trying to tweak this system to look nice, you have to always bear in mind that you are not admitting some superfluous solutions, neither are you ignoring some solutions that were there in the actual system, but now in your modified system that is no longer a solution. So what we are trying to do now, the goal before us that we are going to set for ourselves is this. We are going to say, we are going to get some nice looking structure for A, we are going to try to do that at least, whilst ensuring that this new modified system of equations has exactly the same solution set as the original system of equations. So what is a way of ensuring that you generate a new system of equations which has the same set of solutions? Well, let's do a simple trial. So let me write it down in a little more elaborate fashion now. So let's say this is a11x1 plus a12x2 plus so on, a1nxn is equal to b1. Similarly, a21x1 plus a22x2 plus a2nxn is equal to b2, so on, until the last one is am1x1 plus am2x2 plus amnxn is equal to bm, right? So that's the way it is. Now, suppose I want to cook up the m plus first equation. So let us try to cook up the m plus first equation from these m equations by taking a linear combination. What do I mean by that? What I mean is quite simply this. Multiply this equation by some alpha 1, this equation by some alpha 2, so on, until you have this equation, some alpha m on both sides precisely. So then what do we get? This is equation number 1, this is equation number 2, this is equation number m. So what is equation number m plus 1? Equation number m plus 1 will look something like this. I will write in a shorthand summation notation so you can see it's going to be alpha 1 a11, alpha 2 a21, right? So the sum is over alpha 1 and over the first index, right? Please ask if there's any question about this notation. Alpha I a I 1 x 1 plus summation alpha I a I 2 x 2 plus dot 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 till I have the last term, which is summation alpha I a I n x n is equal to summation alpha I b I, where of course all these I's are being summed from 1 through m, right? So I running from 1 through m, 1 through m, so that's my most general construction of a linear combination, where I can choose these alpha 1 through alpha m to be any real number that I please. Yeah? So far, so good. Nothing wrong with this. Now, what is so interesting or what is so special about this m plus first equation that I have cooked up? So, consider any solution of this original system of equations. Okay? So let zeta, of course, in Rn be a solution of Ax is equal to b. All right? I'm going to claim that zeta satisfies the m plus first equation. Is that obvious? How do you check? Well, the conventional method, left hand side must be equal to right hand side. So you just open it up, left hand side and right hand side, and you equate that. So on the left hand side also, all these terms, they equate to the same as this. It's just substitution, really. If there's any doubt, please ask. I can just do a bit of laborious writing down of those expansions, but maybe I'll leave it to you as an exercise to check. It's really not that hard, right? Yes? What I'm saying is that I had m equations originally. I have cooked up the m plus first equation. This is something that was not originally given to me. This is something that I've cooked up through a linear combination of the first m equations, the original m equations. Now I'm saying that if I know that this zeta satisfies the original system of equations, then this zeta must also satisfy this new equation that I have now cooked up. In order to prove that, all you have to do is to substitute that zeta in place of x. So zeta has n tuples, and every one of those n tuples gets substituted in place of x1 through xn. Yeah, and because it satisfies the original system of equations, you will see that on the left hand side also you will have the same term as on the right hand side here. Right? So I'm leaving that proof. I mean, it's not really much of a proof really, but this is just the assertion. But you'll immediately realize that not every solution of this is a solution of this, because this has a lot of degrees of freedom, right? Just the discussion we had about freedom and constraints. This has presumably m constraints at most, whereas this has at most one constraint. So there are obviously situations where this admits a way more number of solutions than the original system of equations. So just by solving this, you cannot say, oh, okay, I have found a solution to the original problem. So you might need to cook up more of these linear combinations, but what is a systematic way? What is a guarantee that you will be able to do this and still retain and zero in on the original system of equations and their solutions, right? So this is where we are going to make this claim now. Or rather, we should first define something. So this observation, although I have not proved it, please complete this proof. Even if it's trivial, it's apparently trivial, but you should still complete this and convince yourself that it is true. Because every subsequent result that we prove will build on the preceding results. So now we are going to define something. We're going to define equivalent systems. Okay? So what are equivalent systems? Suppose you have system 1 given by Ax is equal to b, and system 2 as a bar x is equal to b bar. Okay? Right? You know the sizes. Let's just say A is A comma A bar. Okay, let's let's not talk about the sizes yet. Let's just keep them different in general right now. Okay. Now, what is it that makes them equivalent? The definition here. Okay. The definition is as follows. If every equation in system 1 is a linear combination of those in system 2, and the other way around, that is, every equation in system 2 is also a linear combination of every system in equation, every equation in system 2 is a linear combination of the equations in system 1. So it works both ways. Then system 1 and system 2 are equivalent. So it's all very well, maybe another definition for you to gobble up and stuff, you know, what's the use of all this? Okay. Why are we introducing this definition? Because the next result that comes up is going to be incredibly interesting. Okay. So what is the result which we are shooting for which we have actually set up this definition? Because we don't want to have to say all this. You see, I told you the other day, the reason we set up definitions is because we want to use, hereafter when we use the term equivalent systems, you'll immediately know what it means. I don't have to always say every equation in system 1 is a linear combination of those in system 2, every equation in system 2 is a linear combination of those in, you see the number of words I'm spending, right? Instead of that, I'll just say they're equivalent systems. So now the first important result is going to be this. If two systems of linear equations, so let's call this a proposition, okay? Equations are equivalent. Then they have the same, or they admit the same solution set. That is crucial, because remember, our goal is to get from one system of linear equations to another system of linear equations that are much nicer, okay, while preserving the fact that we are not admitting any extra solutions, neither are we cutting down on any existing solutions. So if it turns out that there is a way, if this result is to be believed, that is, then it turns out our goal is now reformulated. What is our goal? A way of cooking up equivalent systems, you see. So if this result is true, we should now aim to cook up equivalent systems that look nicer. So once we have a recipe for cooking up equivalent systems, yeah, then we should try to achieve our goal of cooking them up in a way that makes it look nicer. But of course, for that, we need to prove this. Okay, so there's the proposition. Maybe I'll just try to give you a very sketchy idea of the proof, but an important element is here. So how do you prove two sets are equal? What is the most standard way of showing that two sets are equal? I mean, if it's two numbers, you know, there are so many different ways. How do you generally approach this problem of proving that two sets are equal? Yes, thank you. So you try to show if there are two sets S1 and S2, you first show that S1 must be contained in S2. Then you show that S2 must be contained in S1, and if both of them have to be true, then they cannot help but be equal. In fact, the same holds for numbers. If you show that one is less than or equal to the other, and the other is also less than or equal to the first, then they must be equal, right? So that's the standard approach. So let's say, suppose S1 and S2 are solution sets of AX is equal to B and A bar X is equal to B bar respectively. Then what do we need to do? First, we have to show that S1 is contained in S2. This is to show that S1 is contained in S2. So we pick any arbitrary element from S1, and if we can show that it must also belong to S2, then it must be true that the entirety of S1 must be contained in S2, right? So pick any element of S1, say zeta 1. That means A zeta 1 is equal to B, right? But by our preceding result, what does it mean? What do we know about every equation in the second system of equations? Every equation in this is a linear combination of the equations in this, right? And by our preceding result, therefore, if zeta 1 satisfies system 1, which it indeed does because it is a member of S1, the set of solutions of system 1, therefore, it must also satisfy, let us say this is m equations here, then the m plus first equation is the first equation here, the m plus second equation is the second equation here, until the m plus m barth equation here is the last equation here, where there are m bar equations in the second system, let us say. So if that is true, then can I not say that it is obvious that then, so always beware when people use the term obviously, yeah, be very suspicious, even if I am using it. It's a sure shot way of probably cheating people, yeah, obviously. Then obviously A bar eta 1 is equal to B bar, but I hope at least this is obvious. So I am allowed to use this obviously, I have given you the explanation, right. So then any element that belongs to S1 must belong to S2, because this implies that zeta 1 must belong to S2. Yeah. So anything that comes from S1 must also belong to S2. So therefore, what we have essentially proved, I may now erase this definition here, what we have essentially proved now is the fact that S1 is contained in S2. That is, therefore, S1 is contained in S2. But because the definition of equivalent systems entails that the same thing goes for the, when the story is flipped. So now, if you want to show that S2 is contained in S1, take any solution of the second system of equations, that is A bar x is equal to B bar, right? And that must also satisfy each and every equation of the first system of equations. Yeah, because every equation here is also a linear combination of these fellows, right? So by similar reasoning, of course, by flipping the indices, S2 must also be contained in S1. Ergo, S1 is equal to S2. So that means we now need to understand how to get to an equivalent system of equations given a system of equations. What is the recipe for cooking up equivalent systems? Because it turns out that once we are living within the realm of equivalent systems, it suffices if you solve for any one of them. So let us solve for the nicest looking one, the easiest one to solve. If you have done it, you have solved for the entire system of equivalent system of equations, right? All of them at one go. So which is the nicest one? We have to identify. You might argue it is a matter of taste, but there is something that is universally agreed upon as to which is a nicer way of representing, which is the nicest form, yeah? But the question still remains, what is the way to get there? How to get to an equivalent system of equations? For that, we will make a few observations, especially pertaining to this thing that we have been using so loosely up until this point, which is taking linear combinations of equations.